Houston. I grew up during the civil rights period, and I hope that I don't look like I'm 150 yet, you know. And I just want you to understand that that period of time was not really that long ago. And the particular time of the civil rights period that I'm going to talk about is the year of 1963. The civil rights period extended over a period of time, but that particular year was a very pivotal year. It wasn't the only year that was important, but it was very important in some respects, 1963. As a matter of fact, in 2013, they celebrated 50 years of the civil rights movement, and they took it from 1963 to 2013. And at that time, they actually had lots of, let's say, memorial programs or ceremonies to commemorate that time. I don't profess to be an expert by any means. I'm only going to give you my personal experience growing up where I did. And I grew up in Birmingham, Alabama. And it was so notorious for being bombed that they called it Bombingham. And I lived in a section of town that they actually called Dynamite Hill because they bombed the houses so often in my neighborhood. And one of the reasons I was told that they bombed the houses is that they didn't like the fact that some black people had nice homes. And that was one of the sections that people had nice homes. They weren't fabulous, but they, considering the time, now we really have the mega homes because we've got people that make the really big bucks, particularly the, you know, some of the rap stars and some of the athletes, they can have these mansions. So compared to that, they don't compare to them. But at the time, they were nice homes and people were professionals that lived in the neighborhood. And we all were in the same neighborhood together. So the white people knew exactly where we were because there were pockets of black neighborhoods and we all lived in those pockets. And so they knew exactly where to go to bomb us if they wanted to. The atmosphere at the time was really, really tense. And even today, times are tense. But, and you all have your own set of issues in this time period. But we were dealing with basically the black and white issue. Now you're dealing with people that are killing everybody. You know, so it's not just the black people that are targeted. We know that just from a week ago, where this student goes in and just shoots up the school. And he didn't care who he hit, black, white, or otherwise. But at this time, it was basically the blacks that were oppressed in Birmingham and in other parts of the South. So when we talk about 1963, I want to give you just a sort of a chronology of what happened starting in January, okay? So when we start out the year, we have the inauguration of our new governor. And the governor is George Wallace. And George Wallace is the governor that stood in the schoolhouse door to keep us out, the University of Alabama. It's been documented in all of the documentaries that you might see about the times in Birmingham then. But George Wallace did not want to let blacks in the University of Alabama. So he stood in the door and said you weren't going to come in if you happened to be the wrong color, and they had to call out the National Guard so that the school could be integrated. Now look at the difference between what I'm talking about and what's happening at the University of Alabama. Who's on the football team? Us. Yep, so it has changed. It has really changed. But they resisted back then, and George Wallace, in his inaugural address, he said, segregation today, segregation tomorrow, segregation forever. Now he stood there and said that, and some of the people loved it. And so you can imagine if you've got people that go along with a statement like that, wanting to keep, and things were not, they said that things were going to be separate but equal. That was not the case. That was not the case. We did not have equal anything. We would have, when I went to school, we got hand-me-down books. We got the, they bring the books that the white kids had used, and then they bring them to the black community. Our books didn't have covers on them. They had writing in them. They had pages missing. But we all could read because we had all black faculty. All of our teachers, if you can imagine that, principal's black, all your teachers black, and they made sure that you did what you were supposed to do. And you could go home and holler about how mean the teacher was, and your mom and dad would say, I don't care what the teacher said, you do what she tells you to do. Because it was important that we became educated. That was our way out at the time. And it was true. We had to be, when you hear the statement, we've got to be better than. It's true. You can't be as good as. You had to be better than. So that was the atmosphere, and that was what was happening at the beginning of 1963. Well, all of the stores, the counters, the eating, they had no integrated restaurants or movie theaters or anything like that. You know, we had our own black theaters, and they were subpar. They were, you know, you'd go in there and your feet would be sticking to the floor because people had dropped candy and they hadn't cleaned it, you know. And they used to say, you know, when we were teenagers, if you walk in a date with a date and a roach would walk out with you. So it was just that bad. And our school was so raggedy, we had to kind of laugh at our circumstances. You know, we couldn't improve them that much ourselves, other than improving ourselves. And so our school was so old and so raggedy that they used to say that the only thing holding it up were the termites holding hands. You know, and so, but we learned. And we were there in the summertime with no air conditioning if you had to go to summer school. You just throw up the windows. You can imagine how awful that could be. And of course we were used to the heat because nobody had a lot of air conditioning back then. You know, not that that was 100 years ago though. So we had a lot of animosity. You know, you couldn't ride where you wanted to ride on the bus. You've heard of people having to ride in the back of the bus, and you've heard of Rosa Parks and the whole thing about her not getting up out of her seat. You know, all of that was true. And you would actually enter sometimes from a separate door. You know, it was just that segregated. So because people wanted the conditions to change, and it's a funny thing about that. If you grow up and you were born into that, it's like that's all you know. And you think that that's the way it's supposed to be, you know. But then there are people who say it's not supposed to be like that. And so some people thought, well, these are troublemakers that are coming in here telling us that things ought to be different. And they were really afraid. And they had reason to be afraid. Because if you decided that you were going to raise a ruckus and go against the system, they would just, you know, wipe you out. You're dead, and nobody would do anything about it. Because the KKK was the police, you know? And so they weren't going to arrest themselves. They were on the police department, they were the fire department. And so you can imagine how you had to walk the straight and narrow line a lot of times if you were black. And so we had to have our own entertainment. And we had to have social organizations that we joined that were our own. And we had a lot of our activities that took place in the church. That's why the black church was so important, because our social life was the church. And any activities that you would go to, they would be a lot of times at the church, because we could not go to a lot of the other facilities that we had or that were available to other people. So, because people felt like it wasn't the right thing for us to be, you know, separated and not have equal opportunities and equal facilities, particularly downtown, you could not eat at the counters. You know, they would have a restaurant upstairs with tablecloths and all of that for the white customers. And the black people had a greasy spoon joint down in the basement. They would sometimes nail a plank of wood up against the wall, and you'd have to stand there and eat your food. They didn't even have any place to sit. And it was not, it could be dingy and dirty and dark and all of that, just not the same. Even though they were providing a place for you to eat, it just was not what everybody else had. The water fountains, of course, were marked white and colored, and they were not equal either. You would have a water cooler sometimes that was marked white, but we had a water fountain that was not cool, lukewarm water, marked colored. And I remember as a little girl, I just walked up to a water fountain to drink water, and I wasn't reading where they said white or colored. You know, I just wanted water, and I was downtown with my grandmother, and I walked up to the white water fountain, and she just gently walked over and took me by the hand and walked me over to the other one and didn't say anything. And so very often our parents and grandparents tried to protect us, and she didn't say you can't drink that water because you are the wrong color. She just didn't say anything. Or, I'll give you an example of one day we were driving down a busy street with my dad, and they had this big amusement park on Fifth Avenue. And every spring, you could see all of the lights, the Ferris wheels turning, and all of the other lights from all of the other games and things you could see from the street. And so we were all excited and we wanted to go. And so we said, can we go? And my dad said, well, not today. So he did not say, you can't go because you're the wrong color. He just said, not today. So he would rather have us think that he just wasn't taking us than to give us the idea that we weren't good enough. And so astute parents tried to do that. They tried to still keep your self-esteem intact. And that was really, really important. And we have to remember that today, because there are subtle ways that people can make you feel less than, even now. And that they're just slicker with it. You know, and you have no idea that you're being left out. One of the things that they can do is just price you out of it. You can't afford to go. You know, and they don't even have to say you can't come. They just price it so you can't go. It's too high. You can't live there. It costs too much. You know, so there are ways that they can still keep you out. But you can battle all of that. And we knew that. But you can't do it being, as they would say, a dumb bunny. You know, you've got to educate yourselves. So, because we couldn't have equal things downtown, and black people were spending money, you know, we love to dress up at Easter time, get us a new outfit. You know, so black people were buying new outfits for Easter. But this year, they decided we're not spending our money downtown. If they don't hire us even to be, you know, the salespeople in the stores, which we couldn't. You could spend your money there, but you couldn't be one of the person selling the clothes. So they decided that they would organize. And when I say they, I mean college students like you all. There's a school in Birmingham called Miles College. And Miles College is a small HBCU. It's still there. and it has actually grown. And initially, my father attended that little school, and it had three buildings, that's all at that time. And nobody wanted to go to Miles College. You went there if you had no other choice. And my dad really had no other choice, but he wanted to go to school. But there were some outstanding people that went to that school. Who's heard of Condoleezza Rice? She was Secretary of State. Her mother was in school with my dad at Miles College. And so you had people that you would never think that their children would wind up where they are, and they started out at this little school that only had three buildings. Of course, my dad's 96 years old, so that's been a while, but we were still interested in getting a quality education, even if you didn't have a three buildings at your school. So these students at Miles College organized themselves. So if you think you don't have a voice, you know, don't believe it, you do. And just like these high school kids are speaking out now, these college kids have a voice. And so they got themselves together to have a boycott. And there was a minister that helped them. And his name was Fred Shuttlesworth. Fred Shuttlesworth, and it's spelled S-H-U-T-T-L-E-S-W-O-R-T-H, Shuttlesworth. Now, Fred Shuttlesworth was really big in what they call the movement. And every Monday night, they would have a movement meeting at 16th Street Baptist Church. Well, the old black people, including my grandmother, would go to these movement meetings on Monday night. And the black people would talk about who spoke at the meetings. And you know how we can mess up some names, right? Well, the old people, and including my grandmother, they would come home and they said, you know, Shuttlesworth said. And I said, Shuttlesworth? Who is Shuttlesworth? And then I had no idea that the man's name was Shuttlesworth until years later. Because that's what they were saying, Shuttlesworth. But he was the man. And he was fearless. He really was. They bombed his house too. But he helped to organize these college students. And so they had a very, very successful boycott because black people did not spend anything at spring for Easter. And even the little kids, including myself, we were talking about how I'm going to wear what I wore last Easter. And I'm wearing an old dress. You know, so they got us even involved. So we didn't want anything new because we understood what it was about. And if you tried to cross that picket line, you had to hear from all those people. If they were standing out on that sidewalk holding the sign and you tried to cross and go into that store, you better not have a brown face and try and go in there. You know, they really meant business. And so people, they stuck together and they didn't go. And so when anytime you mess with somebody's paper, as you all call it, okay, the Benjamins, then you really do make a difference in how they think. So that was very, very successful. So that happened in the spring. So we had George Wallace standing in the schoolhouse door in January. In the spring, we had this happening, the boycott. Well, now we come around to the month of June. And there was a young man whose name was Medgar Evers. And Medgar Evers was a field secretary for the NAACP in Mississippi. And one of his responsibilities was to register black people to vote. And because he was doing his job, and the vote is very important, it still is to this day. The vote is very, that's why we're always saying you need to vote. They knew that the vote was important. They didn't want black people to have it. And so, on June the 12th, 1963, they killed Medgar Evers. And at that time, you know, music sort of mirrors what's going on in our culture. And so there were songs that were written during that time about what was going on. And so I would like to sing for you the song that I have called Medgar Evers' Lullaby. And I will try and play with my guitar that lullaby for you.
Bye-bye, my baby, I'll rock you to sleep. I'll sing you a sad song, it might make you weep. Daddy is dead,
comes August. And August was when Martin Luther King delivered his I Have a Dream speech. Okay? In Washington, D.C. And you've all heard of that, I'm sure. I sure hope you have. And that march was so successful, but of course, the powers that be didn't like it, because we were getting to be too organized and too solidified, and we were listening to this man. And he was wonderful as far as an orator. He could move you with his speech. And so that occurred in August. In September 15th, 1963, they bombed 16th Street Baptist Church in Birmingham. And in that church, they killed four of my friends. They were Carol Robertson, and that's Carol with an E on the end, C-A-R-O-L-E, Carol Robertson, Addie, A-D-D-I-E, May, M-A-E, Collins, Addie May Collins, Cynthia Wesley, W-E-S-L-E-Y, Cynthia Wesley, and Denise McNair, M-C-N-A-I-R, Denise McNair. Now, Carol and Addie and Cynthia were all 14. And Denise was the youngest of the four. She was 11. And oddly enough, I think all three of the 14-year-olds were born in April. They had the same birth month. Carol, I knew them all in varying degrees. I knew Carol very well. Her mother was the librarian at my elementary school. And she was in my sister's class. Cynthia was, well, let me go with Addie first. Addie was the sister of also one of my sister's classmates. And Addie was a quiet girl, a very nice little quiet girl. Denise McNair, I didn't know her quite as well, but I knew her family because her daddy was the photography teacher in my high school. Mr. McNair, Chris McNair, and he took everybody's pictures. And he had hundreds and hundreds of pictures of her. And they featured, after this happened, they featured a story about her in Ebony Magazine. And they entitled it, Death of an Innocent, because she was less than 12. She was a baby and younger than the others. And they had all of these wonderful pictures that her father had taken of her. And he was a teacher, and so was her mother, and she was their only child. Carol was the youngest child of three, so she had an older brother and older sister. Addie, there were lots of them. She had several sisters and brothers. And Cynthia, I'll tell you about her because she was my best friend at the time. And when she was killed, she was actually decapitated. And the way that they identified her was by a ring that she was wearing. And her father was asking for her when the bomb went off. He went to the church looking for her and couldn't find her. And so he started searching the hospitals in the area. And one doctor said, "Was your daughter wearing a ring?" And he said, "Yes." And it turns out that the ring that she was wearing belonged to me. And we had actually swapped rings as little girls. And I still to this day love jewelry and rings. But that's how they knew who she was. And so when I found out that all of these girls were people that I knew and knew closely, because Cynthia's father was, my mother was a school teacher too. And Mr. Wesley was her principal. And Cynthia's mother was also a teacher, and they lived two blocks from us. Cynthia was an only child, and she was adopted. And so we were her friends. She was always coming to our house because we had four children at our house, and so she was always there spending time with us. And her mother made beautiful clothes for her. And because we were such good friends, she actually, when she'd make something for Cynthia, she'd make something for me. And so we were very, very close. And when the girls were killed, they actually asked if I would sing at the funeral. Well, Carol's family went ahead and planned the funeral for her. And it was really before Martin Luther King and Jesse Jackson and the others could get to them. And when they visited their home, they said, we've already planned her funeral. And they wanted it separate from the other three. So it was actually the day before the other girls. And so I belonged to a group of, there was a trio, and we would sing, and they asked us to sing. And I was trying to remember, what did we sing? It was so traumatic at the time, and we had no idea that this would be such a historical moment. We just knew that we were really, really, you know, devastated and could not believe that this had happened. And black people were angry. They were, you know, talking about the people that are mad on TV now about their children being killed, the same thing then, you know. And they were upset with the movement even, because they thought, well, you know, we want change, and you do want change, you want progress. And sometimes you have to pay a terrible price for change. But they said, you're getting our children killed, you know, with this. And so people were really upset. And so I wanted to just read, let me see, I can find it in here, just a few of the words of the song that we sang at that funeral. Now I'll get my eyeglasses so I can. Okay, the title of the song was The House I Live In. And we thought that this song was just really ironic, and for us to be singing these words at this funeral with the background of why this had happened. And it starts out with, what is America to me? A name, a map, the flag I see. A certain word, democracy. What is America to me? The house I live in, a plot of earth, a street, the grocer and the butcher and the people that I meet, the children in the playground, the faces that I see, all races, all religions, that's America to me. The place I work in, the worker at my side, the little town or city where my people lived and died, the howling and the handshake, the air of feeling free, the right to speak my mind out, that's America to me. The things I see about me, the big things and the small, the little corner newsstand and the house a mile tall, the wedding and the churchyard, the laughter and the tears, the dream that's been a-growing for 150 years. The town I live in, the street, the house, the room, the pavement of the city or a garden all in bloom, the church, the school, the clubhouse, the million lights I see, but especially the people, that's America to me. And how ideal is that? And how untrue a lot of it is for us. But that was what we chose to sing, because that was what we wished for. And that was the price we had to pay. You know, some of us had to die. And that's why it's so important that we vote, that we take advantage of all of the opportunities, because people did die for for us to be where we are. So that happened in September 15th, and in November, they killed Kennedy, November 22nd. So you can see a lot was going on during this year that was just turning this culture upside down. And it all revolved around this movement that was us. And it was important. But I want to really, whenever I come into Mr. Gates' class, I really want to stress how important it is for you all to understand how far we've come and how much farther we've got to go. And we can't be sidetracked by other things, you know, because there are always going to be other things going on in this culture. But we have to try and do the best we can for us, too. And so if you're here at Virginia State, if you improve yourself, what does that do? That improves you, first of all. And then it allows you to help your family. And then your family can spread out into the rest of the community. And then the community can affect the culture. And you can't be, and I don't mean to preach at you, but you can't be swayed by everything that comes along. Please think for yourselves. Every fad that comes down the road is not for you. Every trend that comes down the road is not for you. You know, it might be cute at the time, you know, but you have to try and see the bigger picture. You know, so just don't follow something just because it looks like everybody else is doing it. But one thing for sure is that education is never wasted. Never wasted. We were growing up in all of this turmoil, and I had a friend at the age of 12. He told us, he says, I'm going to grow up and I will be the president of Fisk University by the time I'm 40. And this friend was Freeman Hrabowski, who is the president now of the University of Maryland, Baltimore County. So he got a school a whole lot bigger than Fisk, didn't he? But I'm super proud of him. And he calls me his little sister, and we talk all the time, and he sometimes mistakenly calls me when he sits on his cell phone and says, I didn't mean to call you this time. But he is quite an influential person, and you might think a black man with a name like that, and it is, it's a Polish name. And no one else had that name at the time that we knew of. And it's spelled H, it starts with an R, and then H, H-R-A-B-O-W-S-K-I, Hrabowski. The H is silent. So he was always a smart kid, and he had a goal. Early on, he had a goal that he wanted to really be somebody. Okay, and he did not let anyone stop him. He also was a part of the demonstrations. He got the dog sicked on him in water hoses. And there was a man that was the commissioner of health and safety. And he drove down the Birmingham streets in a tank. And he walked up to Freeman and spat on him during one of those demonstrations. He still remembers that happened. Now this guy was really prejudiced, but yet he was the commissioner of health and safety. You know, and they called him Bull Connor. His name was Eugene Connor, Eugene Bull Connor. So everybody knew, didn't even know his name was Eugene, but everybody knew him as Bull. And he had a white tank. It wasn't just a regular tank, it was actually a white tank that he would ride down the street in, totally protected. And so we had those types of people that were in charge of government. So that is one example of someone who excelled in that environment. Then, I've already mentioned to you Condoleezza Rice and her mother going to my dad's college. Well, Condoleezza grew up in Birmingham until she was about 9 years old, but she still claims Birmingham as her home. And they moved to Colorado when she was 9. And her father was a Presbyterian minister. And he had a church on the south side of town. And I belong to a Presbyterian church on the north side of town. And so because we were the two black Presbyterian churches, we knew each other, the congregations. And so that's, and Condoleezza's uncle lived one house over from where I grew up. And so she came once to visit her uncle. And I was not in Birmingham at the time, you know, because that was when she was Secretary of State. And my dad was still living there, and he talked about how the Secret Service was swarming all over the neighborhood because she was there. And they were making sure that the area was safe because she was Secretary of State, you know. And she was from Birmingham in all of that, the middle of all of that oppression. Another person, have you ever heard of Colin Powell? Mm-hmm. Okay, Colin Powell's wife, Alma Powell, was the daughter of my high school principal. And his name was R.C. Johnson. We called him Big Red, because he looked like he wasn't black. He'd walk down the hallway and we'd say, who is that man? And we were freshmen. You know, we had no clue that that was the principal. And so, of course, we didn't call him that to his face. We did, but that's what the kids would call him. So he was Robert Johnson, and his daughter, Alma, married Colin Powell right down the street from my house at the Congregational Church. Then there was Angela Davis. Have you heard of her? Mm-hmm. Angela Davis came to speak at Virginia State at the winter commencement a few years ago. And she lived right up on the corner from me. Her mother taught the third grade in my elementary school. And she, for those of you who don't know Angela Davis, she was a professor at the University of California, Berkeley. And I think she may be retired from there now. But she was involved in, there was a murder that happened where a judge was killed and some other people. And somehow or another, they thought that she had something to do with getting the guns for the people. But at any rate, she ended up on the top 10 most wanted list for the FBI. And she was an activist, of course, and she had this big fro. And everybody talked about the Angela Davis fro. And she actually had a following with that, all that big hair. But so she was from our neighborhood, and when they were looking for her, we felt like our phones were tapped, because every time you pick up the phone, you hear a strange hollow sound, like you were not on the phone alone. And when they were trying to find her, they actually called my house, and now this is the FBI, and I got all nervous, and I was not there. I was in St. Louis in college. But they were trying to follow a lot of leads to see if they could locate her. And so they called my house and they asked to speak to me. Well, I don't think they really wanted to speak to me. I think they wanted to speak to my sister, because Angela had gone, there was a program that was run by the Quakers. Do you know, have you ever heard of the Quakers? Mm-hmm. Okay, they were part of an Underground Railroad. So they've always been sympathetic towards freedom for black people. Well, they also wanted to help educate black people. And so they had this program where they would come and interview bright black students and put them in schools in the North. Because I already told you what condition our school was in. And so they would want to take the bright black students that they thought would do well if they changed their environment, and they would put them in a different school. Well, my sister got chosen to go to a Quaker school. So did Angela, okay? And Angela started to study Marxism, communism, while she was away. And so they really got frightened, because they were wondering if this program had anything to do with cultivating people wanting to be communists. And so they really were following that up. So they wanted to find out about other people that had gone away to school like Angela had. So that's why I said, they really, I don't think, were looking for me. I think my name came up because they knew my name, because I was always kind of singing around, and everybody, you know, knew and called my name before they would call my sister's name. So I think really that they were looking for her and not for me. But the following year, they did come to interview me so I could go away on the same program, but my parents thought I was too immature to leave home at the time. So they said, no, we think you better stay. So, but she did go, and she lived with a Quaker family for her last 2 years of high school. And that was quite an experience, and they wanted to know, do you want to go to a white school up here, one of the Ivy League schools? And she said, no, I want to go to a black school, and she chose to go to Fisk. So she graduated from Fisk University. And so that was an experience, though, that was invaluable to her, you know, to go away and then come back to Fisk. Who has heard of, I want you to Google this person, you may not have heard of her, her name is Nell Carter. Nell Carter was a star on Broadway, and she had her own TV show called Give Me a Break. So you can look her up. She and I were in the same Sunday school class, and so I knew her very, very well. And so I'm just saying all of this to say that you can control, you know, you can't control where you may have been born or where you grew up, but you can surely control, to a certain extent, your future. You know, so you want to stack the deck in your favor, you know, and do all you can here at Virginia State. We may have our issues sometimes, but we care about you, and you're not a number here. You know, we have our problems, but other schools do too. You know, but one thing for sure is that you may get more nurturing here than you might someplace else. But we can't give it all to you. You've got to have some motivation of your own. And we are so dependent on you young people, because we need you. We really do. We need your energy. We need your brains. And we need your youth, because we're getting older. And we need to have your expertise on certain things. And it's important that you, you know, come through for us. It really is very, very important. Mr. Gates always likes for me to tell you a little bit about myself before we run out of time.
Yeah.
But I like to, I like to tell what other people have done, but and tell you a little bit of how it happened for me coming out of Birmingham.
But Dr., before you do that, you talked about the bombing of the church, and
oh yes,
you had to sing.
Right.
And how many diamonds you wanted?
Sure. Well, the day that the church was bombed, it was really overcast. It looked like it was going to rain. It was really gray outside, but it didn't. And we were sitting at the breakfast table, and all of a sudden our house shook. It was like boom, 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 boom. And we felt it, because I lived on Center Street, which sort of divides the city. And 16th Street was 16 blocks away. So you have Center Street, and then you got First Street, Second Street, and so on. They had placed 19 sticks of dynamite behind this church. And so we felt it in my house, 16 blocks away. It was like that. And we knew right away that it was bombed. We just didn't know where it was exactly. And we surely didn't think it was a church, because houses had been bombed before then. And I'll tell you about one that was just two blocks from me. But at the church, that particular Sunday was Youth Sunday, and it was filled with children. The children that were members there and children that were visiting. And the reason why only girls were killed is the church is on a corner, and there's an alley that runs behind the church. And they placed those sticks of dynamite right there in that corner of that church, right at the alley where it meets the street. And on in that corner in the basement, there was the ladies' lounge. And the girls were in there changing to sing in the choir. They were getting, you know, putting their robes on and things. And so that's one reason why it was just girls. Addie Collins, her family, they had a double tragedy, because not only was Addie killed, but she had a sister, Sarah. And Sarah was blinded by the blast. And one eye, she had no sight in. the second eye was really badly damaged. And it eventually became so infected that she lost the sight in it as well. So she's blind. So they had one daughter be killed and one that can't see. And also when they lost her, the family, they really didn't have the money to have a headstone for her. So for many, many years, her grave was unmarked. And so years later, a group of people got together and they decided that that child needed to have a marker on her grave as well. Because they may have had like 9 children. And so her grave is now marked too. But it was such a tragedy, and the church, and what did I do with my book? I meant to pass it around. You can take a look, and there are pictures in there, and I want you to see, I'm not sure what page is on. They had, in that church, one side of it, they had all of these stained glass windows. They had a huge one in the center that had a life-size picture of Jesus Christ. And then on the sides, they had smaller stained glass windows. Well, if you see that picture, all of the small windows were totally blown out. And then there's this huge picture window with the life-size Christ. And the only thing broken on it is that the face is blasted out. It's the eeriest looking thing. It's just the face of Christ is gone. But that whole big window is still intact. But yet the smaller ones were blown out. And that church was the church where Fred Scholes would meet every Monday night. That's why that church was chosen to be bombed, because that was the church where they had the movement meetings. And so it drew all of the attention. Yes, see, she has it there. See, I don't know how well you can see it, but you see how there's nothing there? Just the face is gone. And you can't see the smaller windows, but there were smaller windows on the sides, and they were all blown out.
Did the people that bombed it, did they get arrested for?
Let me tell you about that. There was one main person, he called himself Dynamite Bob. He bragged about it. He was telling people, he was the one I did it, along with my friends. And so, nothing happened. It took 30 years before he was arrested. And let me tell you one other interesting thing. Who's heard of Doug Jones in the news recently? Doug Jones. They just had an election in Alabama. And Doug Jones was running for the seat in the Senate that Sessions, you've heard of Sessions and Trump.
Yes.
Jeff Sessions, he was the senator from Alabama. So when he became the attorney general, is that what he is?
Mm-hmm.
When Jeff Sessions became the attorney general, that meant that his seat was vacant in the Senate. So Doug Jones is a Democrat, decided he was going to run against, first it was Roy Moore and Luther Strange. They were both Republicans, and Luther Strange lost, okay, to Roy Moore. And Roy Moore was accused of molesting this young girl and several others. He's running for the Senate, and he's a child molester, but yet they were endorsing him. He's the Republican, okay, so he beat Luther Strange. So now we have Roy Moore as the Republican, and then Doug Jones is the Democrat running against him. It was the most tense election because we wanted Doug Jones to win. First of all, you question the character of somebody as a child molester. You know, you don't just vote him in because he's a Republican. But some people wanted him in there anyway because they put party over everything. Well, Doug Jones, the reason why it's so significant to what I'm saying today, he was part of the prosecuting team that convicted the man that bombed the church. Today, in our town, He brought to justice the man that bombed the church way back in 1963. Dynamite Bob lived to be like 85 years old. So he was out of jail all those years. And Doug Jones, along with some of the other prosecutors, got him in prison finally. But he had lived his entire life free. Nobody had done anything. So that shows you what kind of atmosphere we lived in too. They could kill one of us and it didn't matter. So that's why that election meant so much to us. We said, Doug Jones, if the black people don't come out and support that man, and he got this guy locked up, you know, what's wrong with us if we don't come out and put him in? And sure enough, he did win. So when you hear the name Doug Jones in Senate, in the Senate, that's his background. He's connected to the 16th Street Baptist Church bomb. Okay. Right now, in our day and time. And he was a young man when he was first hearing about it. You know, he had to have been, because he's not, you know, super old now. But that case fascinated him. And at the time, he talked about how he was in high school and how he tried to calm the tension, because after a while, you know, they integrated the schools and the kids were not liking it either. But he sort of calmed the situation, being a high school student himself. And so he grew up to be, you know, at least it appears, a decent enough person to want these people brought to justice. And I think there were only maybe two of them, because the others had long since died. You know, so there's still a lot of history that's connected, even now. Am I forgetting anything else about the church? Oh, the day of the funeral, I meant to tell you, when I said that I sang at the funeral, we tried singing. I read the words, and we cried through the entire thing. And that was at Carol's funeral, the day before, the larger funeral with the other three girls. And so we were scheduled to sing for them as well. But they kept adding on speakers, and Martin Luther King gave the eulogy. And he was as close to me as you all are. They didn't even have enough seats for us. The church was so full. We were sitting, it was a raised altar, and we were sitting on the floor of the altar with our little legs dangling over the side. And Martin Luther King was sitting right there. And at the time, we just had no idea that history was being made. You know, you just know you lost your friends and that you're really sad because we were so young. And so I can really empathize with anybody who loses, you know, their classmates, you know, because we all lived in the same neighborhood. We weren't scattered all over town. We just knew each other because at the beginning, remember I told you we lived in close neighborhoods and so many people knew everybody else. And so you better not do anything, because if Miss So-and-so saw you doing it, it was going to get back to your mom. You know, because it was right there in your neighborhood, so you better not try anything. So I'm trying to make sure I'm covering it all, Mr. Gates.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, and I did want to say that Carol, she actually told a friend that when she got older and grew up, she wanted to be a history teacher and to preserve history, or she wanted to do something historical. Isn't that something? Having no idea that she would be in the history books. And they have since, they have built in Chicago a center. It's called the Carol Robertson Learning Center. It's been named after her, but it is dedicated to all four of the girls that were killed in the church. That's why I said I'm really privileged to come and tell you all, whether you find it boring or interesting. I think it's something that, you know, you need to know. And hopefully you'll be much more motivated, you know, as you continue. You still want me to say anything?
But I know you don't have to leave in about another 5 minutes, but there's some real important information that I really want Dr. Sarah to talk about, and that is, while you're in school right here in education, you don't know, Kenneth you know, was a fine vocalist. You know, he could easily be winning a Grammy within the next 2 or 3 years, and he's right in the class right now. You know, that's certain things about Dr. Savage that y'all got to know her history about education she has done. I mean, she's Dr. Savage, but you don't know exactly how she became to be Dr. Savage. So you talk about the airport, the airport in Alabama, what is
it? Oh, yes, yes. The airport is now named after Fred Shuttlesworth. So it's the Birmingham Shuttlesworth Airport. So they have actually named a lot of the streets after these civil rights activists. So that's a biggie, though. You know, and when Shuttlesworth, he did live to be an older man. And my mother made it to 79, but she was in the same nursing home with him. And she thought it was such an honor to just be in the same place with Fred Shuttlesworth, you know, because she knew what he had done and the danger he had put himself in. And in the book, they show where his bombed house. I think they bombed his house on Christmas Eve, you know, and he was the one that helped to organize those college students that got that boycott going. But I always try and stress the education piece because, and I want to also stress is that there were, it wasn't all mean and spiteful and dangerous white people. There were whites that wanted to help you, but they were in danger if they did. So they had to almost sneak to help you sometimes. And that's where my little story comes in. When I started out studying music at first, now my mother could play piano, and so, but she always felt like she didn't want to teach us because, you know, you kind of put your kids off to the side because I've got a load of clothes I've got to wash, so I'm going to do that, you know. So you wouldn't always get a regular lesson. So she decided she would put us under someone else and we'd have a weekly lesson that we had to go to. Well, she talked with a co-worker of hers in school that had two daughters that were taking piano. And so she said, well, who do your daughters study with? And the co-worker didn't really want to tell her at first. And when she did tell her, she says, well, it's a white lady, you know, because that's not something that you could broadcast with the atmosphere being the way it was. And so she did tell her, and she said, well, do you think she would teach my daughter? So she says, well, let me ask her. And so we actually had a chance to study with this lady, but the setup was we would have to go early in the morning on Saturday when no one was downtown. There was a music store down there. The owners of the music store would unlock the music store before anybody else was downtown and sneak us in. And we would go upstairs where they would store all of the pianos, and we'd have our piano lessons up there with our teacher, and we were not allowed to say who she was. Because she would have been in trouble, and we would have been in trouble. And we were, and just think, these store owners that unlocked the door to let us come in, they didn't have to do that. So they were, you know, putting themselves and their business in jeopardy too. And so they had to be kind of silent and discreet about that. So then, my teacher was relatively young, and so she wanted us to start coming to her house because it was easier. She would have to come off, well, they called it, she lived over the mountain, and over the mountain was where some of the rich white people lived. So she'd have to come from over the mountain downtown to teach us. Then she wanted us to maybe just start coming to her house because she was young and having her kids and all. Well, we would have to either go way almost before day or after dark. And when we were going really early in the morning, my mother and the two of us, my sister and I, we would enter the side door from the garage. We wouldn't go to the front door because my mother didn't want the neighbors seeing us walking up to the front door. We wanted to appear to be the help. And so we would go in the side door through the garage, and my mother would put on an apron so that the neighbors would think she was the maid. And whenever somebody would happen by, she would just meander over to the sink and act as though she was washing the dishes. So those are the kinds of sacrifices that people would make to educate their children. And I'm thankful to this day that she did that. Because I'm here having an opportunity to tell you all, and I got an education for myself. So after I had the piano lessons, when I got to high school, I said, well, I want to play the guitar. And I wasn't the greatest on the piano. So my mom says, well, I don't know. You kind of fooled around on the piano. I'm like, and she says, I don't know if we're going to pay for you to do the guitar lessons. And they said, we'll give you 6 weeks and see if you can play anything. You know, and so I got 6 weeks, I could play enough for them to continue for me to take the guitar lessons. So in high school, my elementary school teacher, who knew that I sang some in elementary school, and I used to teach Angela Davis's mother taught third grade in my elementary school. I would go to Miss Davis's class and teach her third graders to sing in the afternoon. Well, the music teacher from my school, when I got to be high school, I was 13 years old in ninth grade, and she took me to Tuskegee HBCU and asked if I would sing for the chairman of the music department. And so she says, bring your music. I'm taking you to Tuskegee this weekend. And so I sang for these people that I didn't know, and the chairman came up. I didn't know he was a chair, and he was also choir director. He said, how would you like to be our guest soloist for our Christmas concert next weekend? And I said, oh my goodness, sure. So he says, I'll send you the music. So I got the music, I learned it in that week, and I went down the following weekend, and I had a chaperone to look after me over the weekend. It was Miss Tuskegee, and I thought that Miss Tuskegee was just the prettiest thing. And she took me to class with her on Friday, and I was with the big girls. And so that weekend I sang with Tuskegee's choir. The next week they said, well, we're going to have a TV appearance and we'd like for you to do your solo with the choir on TV. So this was the following week. So this is when you talk about just learning things that you need to be learning, and then all of a sudden you get an opportunity that you didn't expect. So then when I finished with that, 4 years later when I was graduating from high school, the same person, the chair, started contacting me and said, how would you like to come to Tuskegee to school? And I said, well, I don't know. You know, you don't have a music major. They had a music department, but not a major. He says, well, you can still take your voice lessons, and you can take piano, and you can take the music appreciation, you know, and the general ed courses. So they gave me a scholarship to come, but they said, and in addition to that, we're going to send you to music camp before you get to Tuskegee. The summer before, we're going to send you to music camp. They sent me to Michigan, to Interlochen. I never heard of that music school. And they had, there were stars that were coming in there to perform all summer long. And for us at the camp. And one of them was a wonderful classical pianist named Van Cliburn, and he's dead now. You've ever heard of Van Cliburn? Anyway, you can Google him. But Van Cliburn would come every summer. And that summer that I was there, they came and they said, how would you like to play your guitar at Van Cliburn's party that we're having for you? And so I'm thinking, I didn't, you know, how did that happen? How did I get asked, you know, to play at his party? Then also, 17 Magazine came on the campus. And they had a photo shoot, and they said, we want you to be one of the ones we photograph for 17 Magazine.
All that
you know? So, yeah, it was just crazy. And so then after that, they said, well, you know, we need to start having black people in the Miss America pageant. And so who are we need to, we gotta get in it before we can win it. And so they said, well, who can we put in it? So here I am, short as I am. You know, everybody else is tall in the beauty pageant. But they entered me in the Miss Alabama pageant. And I was the first African American to make the finals of Miss Alabama pageant. And when I showed up for the second round, because you can't just you gotta win, run around and move ahead to the next thing. It's like they were like, is she still here? And I had to go through the interviews and talk to the judges, and they would ask me questions. And you had to stand there and let
bless
them
you.
Bless you. And you had to be interviewed by these judges so they could see how well you could speak. And so that was an interesting experience too. All the time I'm growing. So then after my first year at Tuskegee, my voice teacher, who was the chair, decided he was going to move to St. Louis. And I said, but I just got here. And he says, I know, but you can move to St. Louis too, to the school that I'm going to, and I'm moving my children and my wife, and you'll be like a fourth child, which I feel like anyway, like his fourth little girl. And so he moved to St. Louis and became the chairman of the music department at a school there called Fontbonne. And Fontbonne, and I had no idea, was an all-girls Catholic school. So here I was at Fontbonne, and I was the only black that lived on campus. They never had one on there before, and they only had 12 of us in the school. The other 11 lived at home. I was in this dormitory by myself. But I dealt with it, you know. I had been to Interlochen, and we had some blacks there, but more whites. And I said, okay. And one thing my mother told me, though, she says, don't try and be anything other than who you are. Be who you are wherever you are, and be the best you that you can be. And so they handpicked the girl that I shared the bathroom with, because they didn't really know who to put me with, since that was the first one. And I found out why they chose her. She was really, really very nice, and it didn't bother her at all that I was black. And after that first year, they didn't even bother to choose anybody anymore. Whoever I got, you know. So that was interesting. And so I spent my time in St. Louis, and my teacher entered me in some vocal competitions. And the first time I went, it was my sophomore year, and they had, and I'm gonna make this quick, guys, I know you wanna go. They had all of these people from all over the city to compete. They were instrumentalists and singers. And so they came down to the final people, and they only had eight. They had eight finalists, and four of them were singers. And I was in that four out of the eight. So the conductor of the orchestra saw I was leaving after they had chosen the winners. The winners, they didn't choose a singer. They chose violin and flute. So I said, okay, well, at least no other singer beat me. You know, so I was on my way out of the building, and the conductor of the orchestra saw me, and he says, how old are you? And I said, oh, I just turned 20 yesterday. And I thought that was old, you know. And he says, oh, you're still a baby. You be sure and come back next year. So that really motivated me that he took the time to speak to me. He says, we just think you need, you know, to just grow another year. But they discussed me. So I was important. I mean, I thought that was important. So the next year I went back, my junior year. He talked to me again. They had four finalists that time. And I was in the final four. And he says, we talked, and we were not sure whether you could be heard over a full orchestra. So this year, we want you to work on projecting your voice. And so I said, okay. So this was junior year. My senior year, I went again. And I won it my senior year. And I got a special appearance in the newspaper and everything as the winner of the St. Louis Symphony Young Artist Audition. And from that, I won another competition with the other orchestra, University City Orchestra. And then I worked at Six Flags over the summer in the Palace Theater. And my mom says, they're actually paying you to dance? And I said, well, yeah, mostly to sing, but I had to dance too. And so I worked at Six Flags in the big theater. And that fall, I had won a scholarship to go to Juilliard in New York.
Y'all
know Juilliard? Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Y'all
sure don't. And so I went to Juilliard, and I studied there, and I only stayed a year because I didn't have the money. I said, I'm going to go home, and I will, even though I had a scholarship, they didn't have dorms at the time. So you had to find your own housing. So I had the tuition, but I didn't have a room and board. So I said, I'll go home and I'll teach for a year. But I continued my lessons. And in the meantime, there was a note that appeared on my door. And one, this was before school was out. And I knew it was getting kind of long, but this part, I'll hurry up and tell you. There was a note on my classroom door one morning, and it said, it just had Karen Floyd was my maiden name. Karen Floyd on the outside of the note taped to the door. And inside it said, go to the dean's office. And I thought, well, am I in trouble? You know, why do I have to go to the dean? So I went to the dean, and he explained to me that they had gotten a phone call. And there was a lady who wanted to meet me because she had a competition she wanted me to enter. Now, I don't know to this day how they chose me out of the other students that were there. I wasn't the only black student there. So I called the lady. She told me about the competition. It was a scholarship pageant. And it was associated with the Shriners. So she told me that there was a local pageant. And so I entered the pageant. And I went to her apartment to find out about it. And I didn't know where I was going. It was up in Harlem. And I said, okay, the guardian angels look over me. I don't have a clue as to where I'm going. And I found her apartment. And so she told me about it. I entered the pageant. And I came in second place. And she was so angry with me. Because she said, why didn't you sing in a foreign language? Because they would have been more impressed, the judges. And I said, well, I could have. I knew, you know, an aria in a foreign language, several. And so I said, but I thought this one was, it was a phone conversation. And it was comical, and I'm laughing, and I'm singing high, and I'm talking to this person on the phone. And I thought that that was, would be showy. But no, she says, no, they would have been more impressed if it weren't in English. So I went home, because I said I only stayed that year. And I went home to earn money. Well, I got to Birmingham, and it was over the summer. And one night, this lady called my house, and I was not there. Mrs. Dimmer, the same lady with the competition. And I was out. So my mom told me when I came home, she said, somebody called you, and I don't remember her name. And so she said, but I do know it started with a D. And I said, well, it must be Miss Dimmer. So I called Miss Demery back, she doesn't know, and she says, I want you to come back to New York and enter this competition again, because I think you can win. She says, and I'm sending you a plane ticket. She paid for me to go back to New York. I won the competition in New York. Then I went to the regionals in Rhode Island, and I won the competition in Rhode Island. Then I went to Philadelphia for the national competition. And I won the national, and it paid for me to go to graduate school. So, you just, this is a stranger, guys, that I didn't know. So you have to be careful how you treat people, what impression you're making on other folks, because I had no idea how I got picked in the first place. So don't burn your bridges, do the best you can. And if your best is a C, at least it's your best. But if you can get an A, get an A. And after that, I've had other really wonderful experiences. I sang a recital when I was working on my doctorate, and I got to go to Italy. My committee came up on the stage and said, how would you like to sing those songs that you just sang in Italy? And I got to go. And so that's not something that I planned. I couldn't have planned it myself like that. So I'm just encouraging you all. You know, your color does not have to always hold you back. Sometimes it's you that's holding you back. But lose the attitudes, get along with your teachers, do the best you can, and you just don't know when somebody will just come out of the blue and give you a blessing. Take it from me. And thank you for listening all this time around. I hope you got something for me.